Welcome. Welcome to all those joining us from around the globe in the wee hours of the night, or in the brightness of the morning sunshine, or in the midday hours or the evening hours. Welcome. My name is Reed Summers.
Patricia Summers.
And we're here to gather with you again for the last time in this 2016 Messenger's Vigil. This has been a remarkable journey across a landscape of 40 years of the Messenger's life, landscape of revelation, over 850 angelic encounters in length, 9,000 pages in length, and across a vast panorama of life and reality that extends beyond this world, this place and time, into the greater community of life in the universe and beyond. It's been a remarkable journey. For those just discovering the new message, I welcome you. I welcome you to the new message from God, which is an original revelation from God for humanity, given to awaken the sleeping power of knowledge in the human family. Knowledge being the deeper mind, the spiritual mind that God has placed within each person, which must arise and emerge now to guide us in the times ahead. The new message was given to prepare the human family to face the great waves of environmental, economic, political, and social change now sweeping across the globe. And it was given to prepare us for our destined emergence into a universe of intelligent life, the greater community of worlds. So it's my pleasure to welcome you to all of that. A vast new reality that has entered the world through the man and messenger, Marshall Vian Summers. This is his vigil. This is his vigil in prayer that knowledge may emerge in the human family and that God's new revelation be received in time so that it can serve the world now. It was given to serve the world now. And remarkably, from all corners of the globe, speaking over 20, 25 languages, a member of over 70 nations, people of all walks of life have found the new message and are beginning to respond to this tremendous, deep, mysterious calling, which speaks of a greater life, a destiny that you yourself have. People are beginning to respond to this, and the calling is going around the world. And the activation is happening around the world. And that is exactly what the messenger is here in this vigil to pray for, to call for. So welcome to the vigil. Patricia's going to tell us where we stand in the vigil and give us a brief recollection of each night of this vigil.
Well, it's been quite a journey, these 7 days and nights. And as I look back, I'm in awe, in a sense, because all of what's been revealed here in this vigil emerged over the last 33 years. So when I look back in time to 33 years ago, there was so little we knew. And perhaps that's fitting. I wonder about our capacity when I remember those times and what those times required. It might have been a lot to ask for us to be able to have the capacity to consider just what we've done during this vigil. But there were times, I think, where there were glimpses, and you know, these great, in a sense, images and ideas would periodically shine through. And so we would see things along the way. But it was such a compelling journey, we could only go on. We could only go on and respond to the pressure of the time and the need of the revelation to emerge and be rendered, even if it presented itself, how do I say, in waves, perhaps? Each wave eclipsing the next wave. So we would no sooner arrive at what we thought was an understanding of what Marshall was receiving And then it would be flooded over with some kind of completely new and larger perspective. So it's a little bit like our experience in this vigil. And Reed has a slide that shows us night for night, day for day, the focus of Marshall's vigil and that we have joined him in. Night and day one was really magnificent. What we attempted to do was, in a sense, encapsulate or make small and something very large, which is the mystical cosmology that has emerged through the new message. Amazing. In that night, we journeyed back in time and beyond time, in a sense, to what this revelation presents to us about God. God. And then timeless creation. And then what the new message refers to is the separation, evolution, the universe's, God's plan. These are all elements of this. This word knowledge emerged very early on for us. And now we see where it fits within this larger cosmic plan, the angelic assembly from which came God's messengers, okay, who prepared this messenger to bring forth a new revelation, to expand upon, and take us, in a sense, into new country in terms of revelation, a new revelation and a calling resounding throughout this revelation, continuously, constantly, striking chords all over the place, calling, calling, calling to a deep sense of memory, an incredible sense of responsibility and identity. Nameless in a sense, but real. So that was just day and night one. The second day and night of the vigil was devoted to the process of revelation. And this is a very significant component of the new message itself, because that's exactly what it is. And the revelation that Marshall chose for that day and night was how God speaks to the world. And so our learning process continues, you know. And so now with the perspective offered with this revelation, it was made clear that how God speaks to the world is through knowledge, or our innate intelligence, our deeper mind within the mind. How God speaks to the world is through revelation, and how God speaks to the world is through messengers. Yeah. The importance of the focal point of a messenger who can undertake such a responsibility and fulfill it honorably and genuinely. Yes. Oh, and then on day and night three, we were able to spend time considering the requirements of the messenger, which is itself a revelation. And I don't know about you and if you've had time to either read or hear this revelation, but it's very moving. And it gives us an angle in or a view in to the process of preparation, that there actually was a plan in place that later was, for the most part, if not closely entirely, lived out by the messenger amazingly. Because again, you know, we were young in life and responsive to the process enough, innocent enough, and yet It was very striking to see Marshall meet situation after situation, responsibility after responsibility, mystery after mystery. It was unusually natural for him. This is long before we knew he was to be declared a messenger from God. So it's very amazing. So I hope you'll have time to go back and perhaps read or listen to that revelation and hear the voice speak of this process of preparation. It's really striking. Yeah. And then on day and night four, Marshall felt it was important for us and for him to hold vigil for his mission. His mission. And we consulted the great revelation, the mystery of the messenger. And it lays out an extensive array of his responsibilities and duties, his job description, so to speak, to be literal. You know, if you ever wonder, what is the man doing? What does he really do? You know, and it's a question that might come up because there hasn't been a messenger in our presence for 1,400 years. So this is helpful. This revelation is really helpful in terms of sensitizing us to all of what is in front of him to do, and to consider that with him, to consider the weight of that for him. And it has been so wonderful that over time people have come to help Marshall. And that is helping him with this mission. They assuming their mission is helping him carry his. And you responding in your own right, putting your shoulder underneath this revelation is helping this mission. So I want you to know that. Day and night five, isn't this extensive? This is amazing. This is like quite a journey. I mean, yeah. This is a lot. Oh, we knew we had to take a step up and beyond where we had gone before with the messenger's vigil. So here we are. Day and night five, we focused upon the necessity for this revelation and why now. And the revelation that seems to speak to this very powerfully that Marshall chose was the world must receive God's new message. Very clearly put, there is adamance to this revelation, imperative, importance, urgency. So it lays out the terms along with the times, and what these times require, which is a revelation from God. To help us wake up to our responsibilities as a race. Speaks of the great waves of change. Speaks of our emergence into the greater community. It speaks to the spiritual poverty that has set in terms of our sensitivity to what we most deeply know. The poverty, the separation, the disassociation from one another. Yeah. For this, a new message from God has been sent. Yeah. Last night was day and night six, and we spent time with Marshall considering his calling, which is amongst the requirements and mission of the messenger. One of his most important duties is to call, is to go ascend far enough and high enough up to an elevation where he can begin to both realize his anchor, which tethers him to heaven and secures him here on earth so that he can speak for his revelation, his calling. And it gives us some sense of our calling, how we can help him, and we can help the divine, and we can help humanity. So. And so today and tonight, we arrive at us. You know, us, those of us who miraculously found this revelation. Yeah. And there's a great revelation that we'll be hearing a segment of called Walking with the Messenger. It's very poignant. So, in brief, or not so brief, that's been the journey that we've taken across the arc of this vigil with Marshall. And, I hope this has helped him. I hope this has helped us to grapple with the realities of our existence. And why we're here.
The possibility now is that through this vigil, through this amazing concentration that we've built together over 7 nights, that this can also help the world. This can pass through us, through him, out into the world, so that the voice of initiation, the voice of revelation, the voice of the angelic assembly can be heard all around the globe. And move people in ways that could be quite remarkable. And so this is the possibility, and this is where we go from here. And our invitation to you is to consider if you are called to actually go with the messenger, to walk with the messenger into that future, and to somehow find your place of service and your expression of knowledge and your studenthood and your firm 2 feet in the new revelation. So tonight we're going to take a journey. We're going to take a journey into a revelation entitled Walking with the Messenger. As Patricia said, the new message from God reveals that we are living at a time of the messenger, the first such time in 1400 years. Is that not amazing? Hard to believe? And yet that is what the revelation says. The first messenger in 1400 years. So what on earth does it mean to walk with this individual who is a member of the angelic assembly in the world, here with us, and also a man, a simple and humble man with an enormous mission and a freight train of pressure and intention and communication rushing through his vehicle and his presence on this earth. What does it mean to walk alongside this individual? I'd like to explore this with you myself because I live with this individual and I am very close to him. And I want to make sure that I uphold my part to play, truly, that I really did what I needed to do in the time of the messenger, with the proximity that I had, the service I had to offer. And so Patricia and I are walking, we're going to take a journey with you into this revelation because we all need this education, how to regard this man and this moment correctly and not misjudge it. And then he's gone one day. That's what we don't want. We want to be able to walk with him and assist him in this tremendous mission that he's brought into the world. And so in exploring this revelation, which we will also hear from later, we're going to hear the original voice of revelation. First, we're going to explore passages that relate to the time that we live in, the time of the messenger, the vision and the possibility that this is all leading to. And then in order to get there, the question, who will walk with him? What does it mean to walk with him? What are the requirements? So the words I display next all come from the revelation Walking with the Messenger. And so come to a place of receptivity within yourself. Allow yourself to take in these words that we read and show to you today. When a messenger comes into the world, you see, it sets the direction of the destiny of many, many people.
To think apart from this is to miss one of the critical ingredients to your self-revelation. For this is what draws you out of separation, you see. To realize that the sacred relationships of your life create the context and the meaning of your life, and that these relationships were destined before you came.
Consider that the messenger be one of these sacred relationships in your life. Heaven looks upon him as the great hope for humanity, and all who associate with him and share his destiny as the greatest hope for humanity.
Though he will not be in the world forever, to learn of him in his life is an essential relationship for you now. For he is the bringer of God's new word and teaching for the world. He is the seed of greater community knowledge and wisdom in the world. There is no one else who can do this for the world.
The messenger's task is very difficult. It has taken him years to prepare for it, as it has taken him 40 years to receive the revelation. 40 years so that you could have a chance, so that your great opportunity could emerge, so that there would be a greater hope for humanity, so that humanity could be prepared for the great change that is coming to the world, and for its difficult encounter with intelligent life in the universe.
This is part of the gift of the messenger for you, for he brings not only the message, but he lives the message and demonstrates the message, and has passed through much of the adversities and uncertainties that you will encounter along the way and are possibly encountering even at this moment.
And so this is the time of the messenger. This is the consequence of that time. Next, the vision. Where is this all taking us? What is the possibility at the other side? What is the great good that could come into the world now as a result of the arrival of a new message and a new messenger? And so, if this mission is successful, a great number of people will have to receive God's new message around the world, for it to take residence here in the minds and hearts of people, and then begin to radiate its wisdom, its power, and its efficacy, even to those who cannot receive it, to those who have not learned of it, to those in need, great need, to those who are stricken with poverty and oppression, to those who lead the world's governments and great enterprises, and to everyone in between.
It will take many people strong with knowledge to turn the tide for humanity. And they will have to be in concert with each other sufficiently for their efforts to gain strength and collaboration. Mm-hmm.
And if these two things can occur, if enough people can receive God's new message and become strong with knowledge, then the wisdom and power of the revelation will extend outwards, moving through the minds and hearts of people, born now of those who share the destiny given by the messenger in his time on earth, given by the revelation for all time, given for the value and the discovery of people everywhere, both now and in the future.
Here, all of the religions of the world will be involved. Here, everything that is good will be involved. Everything that has been created that is beneficial will be involved. Everyone who feels a genuine calling will be called and influenced and affected if they can have the opportunity to receive and experience the revelation.
Someday he will pass from this world, and his wisdom will be saved and recorded for humanity. But even greater than the messenger is the message itself, which has been given with great care, with much repetition, with great clarity and demonstration, so that it cannot be confused with other things.
Yeah, what will that time be like? You know, we've only known Marshall being here, you know, individually and collectively. Yeah. So inherent in this question, this quandary of what will that time be like, is a calling for us. Yeah. For our maturity, our capability, and our capacity and resident wisdom and compassion, and you know. So he is a very meaningful point of reference and separation for us, as we refer to this term of a point of reference. So, and he won't always be here with us. So something must be building in his stead here, a reality. And we all have the opportunity to contribute to a new reality and a new way forward for humanity. Because ultimately, that's where he's going, and that's what he's pointing to. That's what the revelation is pointing to through him, that he has yielded himself to, so that its message could be heard. Yeah. Its direction could be seen, could be discerned. Yeah. And I think some of us are innately prepared for a new world. Yeah. Not fully prepared, but we have a sense of the situation. And that in part is what prepared us to recognize this revelation and to know that we weren't ready for what was coming. Mm-hmm. Profound self-honesty propelling us in our search.
Yeah. Good. And we will speak of this revelation, will speak to us of what is required, the qualities required. Next, a single question the angelic assembly asks in this revelation. In these sacred years of the life of the messenger, who will be his companions? Who will be his assistants? Who will receive the gift from him and share it with others? Who? Who will this be? A great calling behind this question. A great degree of consequence and connection to time, connection to decision making. And so, for those of us gathered here, let's consider, what does it mean to walk with him, to walk with the messenger? To walk with the messenger is to understand the revelation as it is pertaining to your own life and to the lives of those whom you will influence.
Yeah. What does it mean to walk with the messenger? To receive the revelation in humility and honesty will be walking with the messenger.
following the pathway that he is blazing for everyone.
To walk with a messenger consciously, then, begins to allow you to resonate with this greater purpose, which will give you a sense of encouragement, courage, and strength that nothing else can provide. For these things now are connected to your destiny and not to other ambitions or activities.
So as you read these, I invite you to hold your life up.
Yeah.
Hold your life like the surgeon holds the x-ray up to the light box. Show me. Show me the state of this person, this individual, through this x-ray. Hold up your life and let this shine through and reveal what you need to know about your life at this time. To receive the revelation is to walk with the messenger. To walk with the messenger is to receive the revelation.
To walk with the messenger is to live as the messenger lives, to receive and adopt the revelation and all that it provides in every aspect of your life. It is to recognize you are part of something very great.
Even if you are alone in receiving the revelation, you are a part of its reality as you proceed. And this reality will grow for you naturally, for it emanates from within you outwardly, adjusting your outer life, affecting your values and priorities, giving you a deeper confidence and a greater strength.
To walk with the messenger is to face the adversity that he will have to face in bringing the new revelation into the world, into a world of contentiousness and conflict, fear, doubt, and aggravation, into a world where even the religions now are polarized against one another and are used for political purposes, generating conflict, contention, and violence.
You will need a greater compass, a greater barometer, a greater ballast to hold your life steady in the turbulent times to come. To share this is to walk with the messenger and to keep him in your mind, for he is here to serve you, and you are here to serve him. Not personally, but in a great effort to save humanity from the unknown calamities that it now faces and will face increasingly as the time continues. So take a moment and yourself. Be with this, what it means to walk with the messenger.
This revelation is a tremendous resource for us. It was given for us.
Remarkably, it's telling us what must be for us, if we so choose to see it that way, and take it on with that degree of seriousness. Must one of the hallmark words in the new message. Not an edict, not a commandment from a high power to some small, powerless, authorityless being. Must. The essential. The clear, the direct, the next step to take. Must.
The truth of the situation.
The truth. So tremendous clarity here.
Yeah.
Not clarity from another individual even, a clarity from a greater association who sees without the resistance and the confusion of this world. And so if you choose to hear it this way and receive it this way, we will now give to you what this revelation says is required. What is required? And we're going to give you only the essence of it on screen, but you'll hear the passages from the revelation. First, you must receive and you must prepare. Quote, it is a great calling, you see, but before you can give, you must receive and you must prepare, for you are not ready for your greater life. You are not ready for your greater purpose, which has been waiting so long for you to begin.
Allow knowledge to rearrange your life. You must allow knowledge to rearrange your life, to bring harmony and balance there, integrity, purpose, and meaning. This will take time, for there are certain things that must be undone and certain things that must be initiated and sustained. For only knowledge can fulfill your life. And knowledge comes from God. Knowledge is connected to your purpose and your destiny. And your destiny is connected to those people who share in its particular expression. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Allow knowledge to rearrange your life.
You must take the steps to knowledge. You must take the steps to knowledge then, or these things will only be a belief and an idea with which you will agree or argue against.
Building the four pillars of your life and stabilize at every stage. What must happen? What is required? Any true student will do this naturally because they are following knowledge. They are taking the steps to knowledge, and they are building a strong foundation for their greater future life through the four pillars of development. The pillar of relationships, the pillar of work and providership, the pillar of health, and the pillar of spiritual development. What is required? Building the four pillars of your life. Yeah.
Next, you must have the strength of knowledge. Huge emphasis in this teaching. And it says, this is a calling to be strong, to be determined, to outgrow little things, to set aside little passions, to build a greater strength and foundation in the four pillars of your life. This is what the messenger does. This is what he asks you to do for yourself, for others, and for the world as a whole. This is the strength that others will not have. This is the clarity that others will not have. This is the certainty that others will not have. So who shall give it to them? How will it be shared in a world of increasing anxiety, uncertainty, and conflict? You will need this inner strength to maintain your balance as the waters become more turbulent, as your ship sways to and fro, as uncertainty arises around you, and hostility and anger amongst many people. You will need a greater compass, a greater barometer in the turbulent times to come.
What is required to see that your destiny is connected to the messenger? You must see that your destiny is connected with the messenger himself, for he is bringing the revelation that will reveal your greater destiny and its possibilities for the future. Yeah.
And so this is what the revelation says is required. We'd like to listen to this revelation now. We forgot to mention, this is actually never before heard or read in the world. This revelation is being revealed by the messenger through this vigil. Yeah. Although I'm getting a shaking head at the back of the room.
Limited availability.
So yeah. It might have been played at a gathering in the past.
Yeah.
It was received in 2012 in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. With great urgency, on a morning with a lot planned, i.e. flying from Malaysia to Hong Kong in 2.5 hours, suitcases packed at the door, ready to leave, the marshal comes out of the bedroom in this state, in this you know, loaded, shoulders loaded, eyes somewhat bleary state that he's been in so many times. And he says the simple words, I need to record. They're here. And so with 2.5 or 3 hours, I can't remember. All I remember it was a little tight. We sat him in the living room of a student who we were staying with at the time. I have a beautiful photograph of Marshall. I just couldn't find it in time. Of him seconds before the revelation began. Looking right into the camera. So I'll find that photograph and share that. There's a real presence to it. And so, walking with the messenger, revealed to the messenger, Marshall Vian Summers, 2012, in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia.
Everyone who can receive the revelation in humility and honesty will be walking with the messenger. In some degree, either great or small, they will be doing what he is doing. They will be following the pathway that he is blazing for everyone. Any true student will do this naturally because they are following knowledge and they are taking the steps to knowledge. And they are building a strong foundation for their greater and future life through the four pillars of development. The pillar of relationships, the pillar of work and providership, the pillar of health, pillar of spiritual development. To walk with the messenger is to understand the revelation as it is pertaining to your life and to the lives of those who you will influence. It is a great calling, you see. But before you can give, you must receive and you must prepare. For you are not ready for your greater life. You are not ready for your greater purpose, which has been waiting so long for you to begin. First, you must allow knowledge to rearrange your life, to bring harmony and balance there, integrity, purpose, and meaning. And this will take time. For there are certain things that must be undone and certain things that must be initiated and sustained. most people are not yet able to carry out such a great preparation on their behalf and on the behalf of others, both seen and unseen, who are depending upon their development. At the beginning, people think the journey is all about them and their happiness and contentment, but it is really about something greater than these things. And they will discover as they proceed that they are learning not only for themselves but for others, and in their own small way for the entire world. For God wills that humanity now learn a greater community way of knowledge. God wills that humanity will join together out of great necessity and urgency to preserve human civilization in the face of great change that is coming to the world. God wills that humanity prepare for its future and destiny within a greater community of intelligent life in the universe. God wills that the religions will cooperate with one another, for they are all born of the same soul. And ultimately, if correctly understood in the light of the new revelation, they all serve the same purpose and outcome, which is to keep knowledge alive in the world, to give people the opportunity to discover their greater life and purpose within the circumstances of the world. Here you must see that your destiny is connected with the messenger himself, for he is bringing the revelation that will reveal your greater destiny and its possibilities for the future. For you see, destiny is everything. For everyone was sent into the world for a higher purpose. If that purpose can be discovered and fulfilled sufficiently, then someone is fulfilling their greater destiny. But alas, most people have not found this, and they have built lives that are not oriented towards this. They are lost in the world, lost and forlorn, even if they are wealthy, even if they have all the privileges that everyone seeks. They are lost and forlorn. Their life is empty. It cannot be fulfilled. For only knowledge can fulfill your life, and knowledge comes from God. And knowledge is connected to your purpose and your destiny, and your destiny is connected to those people who will share in its particular expression. But when a messenger comes into the world, you see, it sets the direction of the destiny of many, many people, either directly or indirectly. To think apart from this is to miss one of the critical ingredients to your self-revelation. For this is what draws you out of separation, you see, to realize the sacred relationships of your life, create the context and the meaning of your life, and that these relationships were destined before you came. How you will find them, and if you will find them, is dependent upon many circumstances here on earth. But you cannot change the reality of your destiny. You cannot change the meaning of your destiny. You cannot alter it to meet your objectives, your goals, your preferences. To walk with the messenger consciously then begins to allow you to resonate with this greater purpose, which will give you a sense of encouragement, courage, and strength that nothing else can provide. For these things now are connected to your destiny and not to other ambitions or activities. To receive the revelation is to walk with the messenger. To walk with the messenger is to receive the revelation. Though he will not be in the world forever, to learn of him in his life is an essential relationship for you now. For he is the bringer of God's new word and teaching for the world. He is the seed of greater community knowledge and wisdom in the world. There is no one else who can do this for the world. In this light, heaven looks upon him as the great hope for humanity. And all who associate with him and share his destiny as the greatest hope for humanity. Though there are other hopeful individuals and other great movements in the world, nothing is as essential to humanity's future well-being, future success, future redemption than this. Here all the religions of the world will be involved. Here everything that is good will be involved. Everything that has been created that is beneficial will be involved. Everyone who feels a genuine calling will be called and influenced and affected if they can have the opportunity to receive and experience the revelation. There is no point in defending one's religious beliefs if it prevents you from receiving the word of God for this time and for the times to come. Those who are humble in the light of revelation will demonstrate their humility and their reverence. But those who lack this humility will struggle in faith, thinking that their ideas and their beliefs are the truth, when in fact they are only approximation to a truth that far extends beyond them and their understanding. To walk with the messenger is to live as the messenger lives. To receive and adopt the revelation and all that it provides in every aspect of your life. It is to recognize you are part of something very great, even at this moment, at a time of its very humble beginnings. Even without recognition from the world, even without prestige, without great monuments, without great ceremonies, without the deference of people everywhere, you are part of something at the beginning, at the outset. And in these sacred years of the life of the messenger, who will be his companions? Who will be his assistants? Who will receive the gift from him and share it with others? This is a time of revelation, you see. It only comes once in a millennium. And you are living at such a time. Does this not shed light on your greater purpose in the world? Does this not have relevance to why you are sent and what you are here to ultimately accomplish? Does this not connect with knowledge within you, which is connected to knowledge in the universe, to the Creator, which is its all?
Good. Take a moment in stillness just to be with this communication. May we receive this message and live accordingly, act accordingly, and take it into our lives so that it becomes real. Nasino vare karam. Trish and I would like to share with you before we speak with Marshall, before we hear Marshall speak to us, the essence of what is most important now and what you can do. How can you walk with the messenger practically? How can you take this up and into your life starting tomorrow, starting next week? And so we're going to share with you simply some essential words that we feel are most important at this time of the messenger and in the times after the messenger.
Oh boy, yeah. We spent time with Marshall considering this, quite some time actually. And each of these elements that we're going to lay before you are already being lived out. That's how we know they're real, you know. And one of the first and foremost elements that characterizes participation is alignment. You know, alignment, and it's needed going forward. This is an enormous world, and it's diverse, admittedly diverse. The society's great task is to help Marshall and the message reach that world. And what's so amazing in these times now is that we're coming to this message from all over the world. So we bring that diversity here. And in these early years, as we begin to venture further and further out into the world, with that diversity in hand, I think the challenge is alignment.
Yeah.
In the face of the diversity of our perspectives and our cultures, alignment, and certainly wisdom in how to reach the various and innumerable peoples, too many cultures to imagine even in one breath. In one world. It's really unique to our planet, I think. But so, entrainment and coordination, entrainment, act in accordance with the society. Certainly, if you have a perspective that you feel is really important, provide it so that it can be considered and integrated depending upon the wisdoms of the time. So, fortunately, we're really fortunate. Marshall's a very wise man, amazingly. So, he's right there every step of the way, hearing us out, hearing what these plans are, and providing us wise feedback.
Revelation says, the one we just heard, it will take many people strong with knowledge to turn the tide for humanity, and they will have to be in concert with each other sufficiently for their efforts to gain strength and collaboration. For our efforts to gain strength and collaboration. And so, know that there is already a mission underway. It's moving through Marshall's life and vehicle. It's moving through the society. It's moving through my life. There is already a mission, and you're invited to come into alignment with it and participate in that mission. The tendency to create another mission. We live in a world of separation. Separation is a tendency. Trying to be unique, special, to make this about you. All tendencies here in separation. And so at this time, in this beautiful, pure, time of the infant, newborn message, newborn in the world, born anew. So important that we be in alignment with the messenger and the assembly and the society, which is the next direct extension of that connection. With alignment, preparation, very important. Strength building. Building a platform in life and grounding your life in the revelation. And to put it simply, to do the work the preparation will require. if you don't prepare, the years will begin to feel desperate. And if you don't prepare, you won't be ready when you'll be needed. And that will probably produce conflict. So preparation and doing the work, the simple work, clearing the way, building your practice and engagement, building your life, the foundation, all four pillars, work, relationships, health, spiritual development, doing that preparation, that will take you to a place where the next great important element can really come into being, and that's participation.
Yeah, preparation and participation, so important. That's, the new message puts before us the question of whether the revelation will take hold. And so the great challenge and the great gift of your involvement is you, through your life, through the practice of stepping up to meet the high standards of this new message, you're taking this into your life. And I would venture to guess you will be changed as a result. And isn't it fitting? Wasn't that the intention all along? We arrive in separation in one condition, but we're headed somewhere. So taking this into your life, grounding this revelation in your existence, your day-to-day existence, in the sphere of influence that you may have in the world, to the extent that that's possible, that's really helping the new message to take hold. So I know our numbers are small, but they're growing. And so that's remarkable. So in terms of participation, it's really wonderful to see you here, to see you there, to hear from you, in some of our various engagement environments, so to speak, that the society is able to create for us. It's so wonderful. It's so wonderful to see you all participating there increasingly. And your participation will take the form of direct assistance at times to the society. It's so important. It makes an enormous difference. It does require coordination. It does require certain skills that some of us have and some of us don't. But it's active and it's lively. It's good. It's good. Yeah.
Good. Yes. Next is patience. I mentioned a few nights ago, I actually welcomed you to something called the slow train and spoke of an anomaly, which is, why is it so hard to get on a slow train? And so do know that this is a tremendous undertaking. There are so many facets, rooms to this mission building, this mission environment, that all have to be supported and serviced and taken forward concomitantly at the same time, all together, all at once. And so we're going slower than perhaps we may want to go, but that also gives us time to come into alignment, to prepare. Okay, so patience is very important. Always remember, this is a great coordination, guided from a higher power according to a greater plan beyond any of us. And it is originally that thread originally entered the world through the man Marshall Vian Summers. And from there, it passed to those closest to him, and the coordination goes out. As more and more and more people become involved, it's going to be a challenging and patience-requiring endeavor. So this is a coordination. It's not about me or you getting what we want, being who we think we are, being special and unique, looking good. This is a coordination. And so patience will be very important.
Support is really important. It's really important. This message is enormous in scope. And I think when I look back in time, to its earliest years, it was always enormous for us. Can you imagine when Steps to Knowledge arrived and what that felt like? I remember looking at that pile of paper in the printer, like this, that Darlene had just transcribed. I don't know how many days or hours, I don't even know. Flipping that over, and from the moment it arrived, it required our support, you know. And some of the earliest students to find Marshall were the initial people to provide the support, to pay for the print runs. And there were miracles along the way, you know, miracles along the way. People that we never knew had found the new message, knew that they needed to help, and called and just pretty bluntly just said, how can I help? Had important moments and junctures. But there is always that uncertainty, you know. And so we struggle to be properly funded to meet the task. And but this is one of the great ways you can participate in whatever way that you feel called to. Studenthood, service, speaking for the new message, advocating for knowledge and support. It's becoming, I mean, all those elements together create a very solid presence as a student and as a participant. So I'll just say that. And we're grateful for all the support we've had to get us where we are today. And our mission continues to grow larger. And, so we'll just take our steps. We'll just meet it the best we can, which we have so far.
Yeah. I wonder in 100 years, someone finds a new message, will they think, how can I support this? Or at that point, it'll be, how can I use this? How can I get what I want through this? What is this? You know, and so support has been there, like Patricia said, from day one, this newborn revelation. My parents supported it the whole way. I'm coming to support it. And so many others down into time, you know, down through time will be called to support, to just provide support. To provide support, you have to ask, assess what's needed. What does it need? What do I need? What do I want? And so there's a receptivity that comes with support to discern how to support. Pressure. I'm sure you've been feeling this the last few days to some degree. Pressure is a fact of the time. It's a fact of what this is. And there is a constructive pressure present in this space. And the messenger has had to yield to it and move with it. And so to yield and move with that pressure is very important. Again, in a coordination, when those guiding the coordination speak and we can barely hear it, if ever hear it, it's pretty difficult to coordinate under those circumstances. And so there is a pressure, be it unspoken, felt, that is seeking to move us to be into position. And that's important.
Unity. Yeah, it's the great coordination. We hear this term, the great coordination. It ultimately speaks of things angelic, expressing itself in the world through us, through the revelation, through Marshall. Unity. Unity. In community. This just seems to be happening. There's a harmony, amazingly. I can hear it. I don't think I ever dreamed I would experience it to the degree that we are. Yeah. We are a greater community of intelligent life within this world. Emerging into a greater community. This requires unity. Mm-hmm. So let it begin with us, yeah, between us. And that's something that I think if the world is coming to find this, that's something that's very discernible That's one of those things that we have the innate ability to just recognize. Mm-hmm. Whether there's a harmony or a disharmony. So I think there's a unity growing here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we have this incredible revelation that continues to call us. And we hear it and we respond. And it brings us to great meeting places and working places and places of realization between and amongst ourselves. Mm-hmm. So this is good. I think we've got this going on.
Yeah. Yes, it is felt in the room here. Those at a distance, I don't know if you can feel that harmony, but it's pretty remarkable in the room here. That resonance. Synchronous frequency. The frequencies are starting to line up and move together. This is hardly the last. It's just another very important aspect that came to mind today for us is humility. It's just to be humble in the face of all of this. This is not to build us up into people who think they have the newest, best, biggest, most true religion on earth, and other people have the old religion and they need the new religion. It's not a better than, it's not a more powerful than, it's not to build us up as separate individuals. This is to make a vital contribution to humanity, where humanity is, because God does what works. And those who are members of another faith tradition, doesn't matter what we think, doesn't matter what they believe to an extent, that's their faith tradition. And knowledge can move through them. They can hear the truth still.
Oh, yeah.
And so this isn't to build us up into anything. This isn't to differentiate us, to make us us and them them. This is a gift that needs to flow into the world. And the last thing we need are fences and walls and moats, you know, to further demarcate the lines of separation on Earth.
That would be painful.
The next step in humanity's evolution is to go beyond those lines of demarcation, to be a one world, one humanity. And so the new message brings tremendous compassion for the existing faiths of the world, for all the different circumstances and predicaments that people find themselves in. And there's a tremendous amount of acceptance, true basis for forgiveness, and a sense of brotherhood, sisterhood in the world. So humility. And there are more, by the way. I can imagine these two columns of words just kind of continuing, you know? I can think of so many other things that are simply demonstrated to be important. So. And then the word participate. I'll spend a brief moment here. How can you participate in the worldwide community of God's new message? This is the community called to walk with the messenger. And so how do you participate in this community? It's quite simple. Through your studenthood, by living, embodying, demonstrating the teaching, the revelation through your life, through your words, through your actions. Through service. Service both to the new message and perhaps to the society, or service out in the world. Because there are many important causes that need to take the next step. And some of you were born into the world to make that happen. And if the new message can activate that service, fantastic. And so, you know, whatever that is, whoever that is to feed, to help, to support, animals to protect, land to restore, water, air to purified and to cleanse, whatever's true for you, the new message is here to activate your awareness of that and to give you the steps to fulfilling it. If your service is to the new message, there are wonderful ways to serve the new message through your advocacy, simply by sharing the revelation. Nearly everyone here is doing something to share this, to extend it, to contribute financially. Super important, because it takes a lot of resources. If only I could share with you an image of the back of the room, the cameras, the switching, the live broadcasting. It's taken a lot of resources to bring this to you. And then for some, they will feel the calling to support the society directly through volunteering. So that's also an option. And then lastly is relationship. And that is the strong cable line that binds you to those who sent you, to the messenger, to certain other individuals in the student community, to the worldwide community as a whole, and then out into the world in remarkable and mysterious ways. Mm-hmm. So, relationship. Good. We're going to take a moment of stillness now and prepare to be with the messenger one last time during this vigil.
From my position, I must ask a lot of you. Not just to give your resources, but to rise to a different position in life that is yours to arise to. I did not put it there. I did not invent it. It's not an intellectual enterprise or exercise. I need you to be who you were meant to be and to do whatever in your life you must do to pave the way for that. You will have to know what this means within yourself. It is a greater truth and honesty that not many people in the world have really faced and taken on. And it's for a greater cause, greater than your happiness, greater than your contentment. Greater than the fulfillment of things you might have thought you wanted to do in your life. For God has another plan for you. And it is within you, waiting to be discovered. I must call upon that in the light of revelation. For we live at a time of great consequence. We're living in a time when the earth is going to change in ways that have never occurred in the time of human civilization. And it's going to happen much more rapidly than people expect. So there is no comfort zone left, truly. It is a time to rise. This is what the revelation is calling for. This is what I am calling for within you and others who will witness this broadcast, who will discover the new message through you or through others. It asks a lot because you have a lot to give. And if you do not give this, your life will be frustrated and unhappy without peace or contentment. For there is no satisfaction, really, if you do not do what you came here to do. It is not to be magnificent. It is not to be pure. It is not to be enlightened. It is not to have awesome powers or have great recognition in the world. It's much more simple. But it is a platform upon which you must rise to. And God has provided the steps to enable you to do this. Without believing in a pantheon of gods, without worshiping a messenger, without deifying yourself or others, without fantastic tales of creation, without an endpoint, without a judgment day, without hell and damnation, all the things that have been added over the centuries. So revelation comes again. It's overtaken my life. And at some point, God must overtake you. God will overtake you. And when revelation comes, it asks a lot of people. It puts more in front of them than they would ever put in front of themselves. It challenges their core beliefs. It challenges the religious institutions of the day. Think, have the messengers in the past ever been well received by the religious leaders and institutions of their time? Of course not, because God is not bound by our understanding, our beliefs. No matter how firm and fixed they may seem, build your fortress of belief. Make its walls 10 feet thick. It's nothing to God. When God comes again, God brings something new and revolutionary that sets in motion a beginning, a catalytic effect of change sweeping over people, in people, through people, between people, over time. What we don't have now is time. What took centuries to bring a revelation around the world now must happen in 10 years. And we have the technology to make that possible as long as it may last. Great truth comes with great urgency. It is not something merely to be considered. Another revelation will not come for a very long time. That is what the revelation says. So there's no plan B. There's no alternative. So I must call upon you and the world to receive God's revelation in honesty and humility. Allow it to illuminate your faith tradition if you have one. For all great faith traditions were initiated by God and have been changed by man. I call upon you in this to give up self-importance, or to think that this is all about you and your happiness and fulfillment, or your healing, or you were sent here for greater things than that. And in your heart, you know this to be true. And I call this from you. And I focus upon this in you. And I know how difficult it is to open up to this. I ask you to receive the voice of revelation, such a voice that spoke to the Buddha, the Jesus, and the Muhammad, is now being heard in the world for the first time. This is not a matter of belief. It's a matter of recognition. Belief is weak, it's fallible, easily corrupted, controlled by governments and other powers in the universe. What God has put within you to respond cannot be corrupted by the world. What else would you ever want to trust within yourself or in one another than this which God has put within you to trust and to follow? I call upon you to study the revelation slowly, deeply. It's too big for you at the outset. It is simple in words so that it can be translated easily amongst the tribes and nations of the world, but you cannot exhaust it. It takes you somewhere your intellect cannot go. It takes you somewhere so primeval and primal within you, the you that were you before you came and who you will be after you leave is where it takes you. Now, in this world, encumbered as you are with everything of the world, it does this. You're going to need a strength bigger than willpower, bigger than belief, bigger than personal conviction to face what is coming over the horizon. The revelation reveals what is coming over the horizon and where we stand regarding intelligent life in the universe. For we are not the only ones who have an interest in this world and to seek to have it for themselves. Personally, you're not big enough for this, but I'm not talking about you personally. I'm talking about what's in you that is permanent and strong, that God created, not the part of you that is a cultural product. I'm talking about the part of you that came here on a mission, and that mission lives within you and waits to be discovered, recognized, and fulfilled. That is what the revelation is speaking to in you. This is not about personal enhancement. This is not cosmetic. I call upon you to refrain from judging or condemning the new message based upon religious belief, ideas, principles, or institutions. For God is not bound by these things and only gives humanity what it needs at this time, this great turning point when the world is about to change. I call upon you to go where I am going, to do what I am doing in your own way. Use me as a model if you wish, or not. In the end, it is all about what knowledge directs you to do and your fidelity to that. But to follow that, you must know the difference between knowledge and your own intentions or the intentions of others or what you have been taught to believe. Such a teaching could never be given in the ancient world because people did not have the freedom to follow something of this nature. Only the prescient, the select, the mystics could go on this journey, which now must be your journey in physical life, in practical affairs, without retreating from the world. I call upon you to use the directives and the teachings to refine your life, to deepen your understanding, to find out for yourself what is true within you and what must be done in your life. It will give you more to do than you think you can do. So even if you do only a part of it, it will make a big difference. I call upon you to prepare for the great waves of change and to look into the world for the signs of the great waves of change with as much objectivity and courage as you can. You will be shocked at what is coming over the horizon. But you must see it. You must let it reshape your life. You must let it make you sober about yourself without losing faith in what you are here to do and in the power that God has put within you. For knowledge is not afraid. Knowledge is not discouraged. This is the opportunity for which you have come. For you to see it is a wonderful thing from heaven's perspective. I call upon you to take the voice of revelation into the world. You cannot teach the new message. You do not have the power of initiation in your voice. What you can do is bear witness to it, to speak of it in terms of what it has done for your life and its benefit for the world as you see it. But let the voice of revelation have the power to call upon those who are ready. Use my voice in the world for the same purpose. This will make your task much easier. You point the way. You bear witness. That's what you can do. I tell you these things because this is what is needed. This is why you have come. Or you would not be here with me tonight. There are no casual observers amongst you, no matter what your conclusions. But you must respond strongly, for time is of the essence. A great deal must be done in the next 10 years. So I give thanks that you can share this vigil with me. Hear these words. Be challenged. Be struck. Be encouraged. Be scared. Be emotional. Be judgmental. Anything. Everything. For you will go through all those things in responding to revelation. Why? Because it asks so much of you. May the blessing be upon you and with you. My heart is with you, all of you. I'm grateful, but I'm very clear about the challenge ahead. May we all rise to this great occasion for which we have come. For only in this will our mission be fulfilled. Look to the world. It will tell you what is coming. Look with clear eyes without preference and condemnation, and you will see the signs which you did not see before. The power and presence be with you. Heaven watches to see who can respond and to bless us as we continue and try to proceed.
Just take a moment or two of stillness. quiet. Quiet. Go into the quiet. We have come a long way to walk with the messenger. Long way. And we have a ways to go with him. Nasin of Arikaram.
Wonderful. Thank you for joining us all across this vigil. I have some gratitude that I absolutely must communicate for those who made this possible. First off, thank you, all those who came night after night in every time zone, or nearly so, of the earth. We knew you were out there. We've read your comments here in the room. If you'd like to share any comments right now using the chat feature, we will read those in the room and we will be with you after the broadcast closes. Thank you for joining us in the UK, in France, in Spain, all across Europe, Russia, Korea, all the way across Asia. Unbelievable that you were holding vigil at such a difficult, awkward, inconvenient time. We got the good time. We got 6 or 7 o'clock. So you took what was given, and you gathered, you came. Thank you. Thank you to the Society for all the preparations, the announcements, the outreach, hosting all the visitors. We have over, I don't know, how many do we have in the sanctuary? Seven. Don't tell the police. The fire warden. We are over the capacity, the official capacity room. 70 people here in the sanctuary. I don't know if we've ever had 70 people. We have never had 70 people here. That's what the nodding heads are telling me in the back of the room. So thank you to the broadcast crew who night after night and during the day, testing, fleshing out the issues, making it work every night. Huge offer and gesture of time after work, during the week.
Through sickness and in health.
Right. Yes. Huge. For all those who prepped, cleaned, reset the sanctuary, the foyer, the office, thank you all. Food, flowers, everything you've done, beautiful flowers here. They've been gazing at us for nearly a week. Total community effort. If you haven't had a chance to be here at the Greater Community Sanctuary, we highly recommend you come. It's a very special place, and there are a number of very special people who look after it and keep it really beautiful and spacious and pure. So thank you all who came night after night here in Boulder, Colorado. Thank you, Marshall.
Yeah.
It's his birthday today.
It is his birthday.
He spent it with us.
He did. And so let us re-echo his words before we depart each other. He said to us, I need you to be what you are meant to be. This is a time to rise, to do what you came here to do. At some point, God will overtake you. Revelation asks a lot of you and others. Receive God's revelation in humility. Receive the voice. Study the revelations. What is strong and permanent within you? He asked. Yeah, shining the light. Take the new message into the world. Heaven blesses us as we try to proceed. So, thank you. Right.
Thank you. Good night, good day, good morning. We will see you at our next gathering point on the Great Road of Life.